Good afternoon, everyone. It's really fantastic to be here again with you today. Before we start, I'm just going to go through a few housekeeping bits and pieces. Just a reminder to make sure you all have your, you keep your mute, your audios on mute. You know, because we sometimes get background interference. So please, please ensure that you keep it on mute. If you have any particular questions or any comments that come to mind throughout this program today, please put your comments in the chat section, which is in the bottom middle part of your screen, just in case you haven't used Zoom before. When we come to the Q&A section, you'll see there's like a little reactions button at the bottom right-hand part of your screen. If you can use that just to either raise your hand. Sometimes I'm not able to see everybody on the screen, so I don't know who wants to speak. Otherwise, yeah, please just use the chat and contact me either directly using that chat facility or just speak to everyone there. If I'm a little bit tired today, forgive me. It's been a really fantastic but phenomenally busy Black History Month for me. It's not normally this busy. We recently had a two-day conference, which took a lot of organization. And Claudia Tomlinson, who's one of our speakers today, was also a part of that. So she'll be able to vouch for how busy that was. But before I formally start, I just wanted to mention there's three books that I wanted to bring up just because it was Black History Month and also because they relate to Guyana. And I just wanted to recommend them as books that you might be interested in reading. And the first book, which is currently available, I think, well, it's available by Amazon. And I know David Alston's online, so perhaps he'll be able to share with you where else you can buy it in case you prefer not to buy from Amazon. But it's a book called Slaves and Highlanders, and it's by David Alston, who many of you will have heard before. He has been a speaker on Guyana Speaks. Maybe 2 or 3 years ago now, actually quite a while ago, because it was an in-person event, not a Zoom event. And it's been published anyway by the Edinburgh University Press. So highly recommend it. A lot of the book addresses slavery within Guyana. It touches also on Grenada and Jamaica and other parts of the Caribbean, but a huge chunk of it relate specifically to Guyana. And also the wonderful thing is they've used a painting by a Guyanese artist, Dudley Charles, for the front cover. So you'll see at the back a painting by the Guyanese artist, Dudley Charles as well. So it's a really great book to have. Oh, and Rod is saying that I should point out that Rod and I did the forward. so some plugging going on there. The other book that I'd really like to recommend, it hasn't come out yet. It's going to be out, I believe, in January next year. I've just had a forward, a proof copy sent through to me. It's by somebody called Thomas Harding. And it's basically he's revisiting the history of the Demerara Rebellion. The 1823 Rebellion. And it's an absolutely brilliant book, I think. But also it feeds into this discussion on reparations. In fact, both of the books are really good. If you're interested in reparations, I'd really highly recommend both books. The other book that I recently came across that I just love, it's not to do with Guyana. It's written by an African-American author. But I just thought she's a scholar who focuses primarily on the history of women in slavery. But she's written a book, it's called Wake, The Hidden History of Women-Led Slave Revolts. And I bought it thinking it was a standard text. And actually it's a kind of a graphic novel and a memoir, but it's absolutely brilliantly done. And she offers a really interesting kind of conversation into how we kind of, you know, given the amount of erasures and distortions around women's involvement in slavery, she kind of talks about how you do the history of finding out what those women did. So it's really interesting from not, you know, from that perspective as well. And I will, David, thank you for your comment there. Put these details into the chat as we go along. But meantime, I just want to extend a huge warm welcome to our three distinguished speakers today. So we have Arthur Torrington, CBE. Everybody here in the UK will be familiar with Arthur. He does sterling work with Windrush Foundation and seems to be completely untiring, never stops. A huge contribution to the Black community, for which we're all very grateful. And but also Claudia Tomlinson, who's here. Claudia is a PhD candidate who's also doing fantastic work into, I think primarily Jessica Huntley, but we'll talk more about that when I introduce you formally to Claudia. But we've also got Professor John Rickford. And so it's gonna be a very full program today. And I really hope you'll enjoy it. You'll have heard the record went on. And so it's just to make sure you should all be aware, it's being recorded, and all the Guyana Speaks events that we have via Zoom are recorded. They end up being downloaded onto YouTube so that you can share it with your families and we can kind of broaden the distribution of these discussions. And then they're uploaded also onto the Guyana Speaks Facebook page. So for those who are new to Guyana Speaks, just to say we're a small little initiative. We started in 2017. It's essentially myself, Winita Cox, with my husband, Rod Westmus. Many other people have been involved in helping us, including Greer Westmus, Tafawa Ntun, who many will have known from the classic. Many, many people help us. And of course, there's always our regulars who we're extremely grateful for and who help to make the Guyana Speaks events very rich. So without further ado, I just want to start with introducing Arthur Torrington. He's gonna be our first speaker. So we'll have Arthur first, then Claudia, and we'll end with John Rickford, go on to Q&As. For those who haven't been here with Guyana Speaks events before, just to say, it's like being in my living room, essentially. It's very relaxed, nothing particularly formal, you know. So, you know, when we do the Q&A stage, please ask anything you want to ask. Please feel free to network with each other. Part of the reason why we really enjoy these events is that it's Guyanese people being able to catch up with each other across time and geography, et cetera. So, and also, you know, non-Guyanese, obviously hugely welcome as well. I mean, we're all here as one big family. So I just am going to share Arthur's bio. So Arthur Torrington, of course, is Guyanese born and a huge community advocate, as I suggested. He's a co-founder with the late Sam B. King, MBE, of the Foundation Windrush and the Equiano Society, which was essentially established in London in 1996. Through Windrush Foundation, a registered charity, Arthur designs heritage projects that celebrate the history and heritage of African people. Both organizations publish the contributions of Caribbean men and women who settled in the UK before and after the 22nd of June 1948, especially those who served King and country in World War I and World War II. Also, through the Equiano Society, Arthur highlights the life and times of Olaudah Equiano, a former enslaved African known as Gustavus Vassa, the African, who served as a Royal Navy sailor, a war veteran. He was a businessman, he was an explorer, human rights campaigner. He was also a best-selling author and abolitionist living in 18th century Britain. Arthur is a founder member and chairman of the African Heritage Forum, which is also based here in the UK. So I'm going to hand over to Arthur now, and I'm going to be helping Arthur with the PowerPoint. So
okay.
I'm going to share my screen essentially. So let me just see that I can find the correct. That's not the one I want to share. Is Arthur? No, not that one. Sorry, I've got three different slides open. This is the one I want. Here we go.
So, well, lovely. That's good. Thanks a lot. Well, thanks for inviting me to have a word or two about three men, and we can only deal with three men today. And these three men are all Guyanese who were on the Empire Windrush. So we don't believe that there were only Jamaicans on this Empire Windrush. We hear a lot about 492 Jamaicans coming on the ship. Well, there were more than 492 Jamaicans, possibly maybe about 550 Jamaicans, 307 from people from Bermuda, 264 Trinidad, 45 Guyana, 5 Barbados. And I can go on to say a lot about those who were on the ship. We're still doing studies about the ship, because these were the pioneers. These were the men and women who laid the foundation for us who have come later, and those who came in the 50s and 60s and 70s. These men and women, we only have three men today, laid the foundation. They suffered a great deal, you know, to survive, challenge racism, and lay this foundation for us. So what we're gonna do, these are three men. The first one on the top left, his name is Edwin Ho, of Chinese origin. He also served in King and Country, RAF. Then he came back later on the ship. I'll be able to tell you a little bit more about him as we go along. And then in the middle, we have Harold Simpson, another Guyanese. He served King and Country. And on your very right, you've got Donald Clark, again, serving King and Country before 1948, all right? These men were serving 1943, 44, and up to when the war was finished. Okay, let's get the next slide. Okay, now it's important for me to tell you that there weren't only men serving. Yeah, bottom left, you've got lovely ladies who are serving, attached mainly to the army, but not serving on the front line. They're serving in hospitals, in the office, the drivers, all kinds of different things on the home front. I put a slide at the very top. These are the men in 1914. So we also deal with those who serve in 1914-18 war. And here are the men from the British West Indies Regiment, all right? That's important to note. There were two different regiments. You had the West India Regiment, the first West India Regiment, and then you also had the British West Indies Regiment. You had two different regiments in the First World War. And then in the middle, you've got men, but one from Barbados, one from Trinidad. These are pilots, these are serving King and Country. And it's important to note that these are the men who laid the foundation, because many of them remained in the UK. And we still regard them as among the Windrush generation. And on your right, you've got Mr. Sam King, the late Sam King. He was in the RAF. He also served King and Country. Demobbed in 1947, came back on the Empire Windrush in 1948. And again, were it not for Sam King, there wouldn't be Windrush being commemorated or celebrated. He was the one that kept the name alive from 1948, all right? I know that because I worked with him for many, many years, more than three decades. So in that sense, we need to thank him for his vision in terms of, you know, featuring or having us remember the Empire Windrush as an iconic ship, a ship possibly in the line of the Mayflower. I mean, that was his idea, you know, in 1948 when he came, he felt that those who were coming to Britain from the West Indies were coming going in the same way as the Mayflower people who were going to start a new life. Okay, let's get the next slide. And note, this was the condition of the UK, mainly London really, where buses are trying to get into homes, into ditches. Britain needed to be rebuilt. And this is exactly why so many people came back. Not only from 1948, all right? I know people, I talk to people, or I have done so, who came back in ships before 1948. For example, my late friend, Alan Wilmot, he came in 1947, December. He passed away just about two weeks ago, I should say. And he came early 6 months before the Empire Windrush. Okay, next slide. It's important for me to show you these images to give you an idea of you know, the history and the heritage, an idea in terms of who were coming. This particular ship, as you could see, there were many different people on the ship, different ethnic groups. You had Indo-Caribbean, you had African-Caribbean, Chinese, Caribbean, you know, Euro-Caribbean. I mean, there were so many different people on the ship. You also had people, one in particular whom I know about from Burma, and one from Kingston, Jamaica, who was of Scottish heritage. He's no longer around, but I know his daughter. His daughter was the age, I think it's 1.5 when she was on ship, so she can't remember very much. Somebody from Africa was also on the ship. And then you also had 66 Polish people on the ship. And they were refugees because there were Polish refugees who had been taken prisoner by the Russians. Russia invaded Poland, took these prisoners. Of course, there were children and ladies and men, and to Siberia. And eventually, Russia let them go. And indeed, you know, what happened there was that they had to be distributed, I should say, or they had to live in various parts of the world. Some of them lived in what we now know as Zimbabwe. And then some went as far as Mexico. So these are the people on the ship, all right? We're mainly dealing with those who came on the ship and not so much those who came later on, because these are the pioneers, all right? These are the people like, you know, those who went on the Mayflower. Okay, so let's go to the next one. No, sorry, before you go, let's go back. Sorry, Juanita. Now, on your right, I shouldn't forget this one. Here are three men who were picked out, you know, by the photographers. They didn't know each other, but because they were so well dressed, picked them out. So I know one of them, the one on the right, John Richard. He's still alive. He's 96 next year, and he was on the ship, and he's doing very well. You know, very, you know, good memory and everything at 95, 96 next year. Okay, let's go to the next one. Right, and just to give you an idea of what happened afterwards, then quickly, what happened afterwards in terms of the nurses who came to help the, you know, the National Health Service. And I must say as well, is that there were 9 nurses on the Empire Windrush, all right? I don't know much of them. We're still researching who they were, whether they were coming directly to join the NHS or just to join a hospital. And so we're doing some research. Britain also wanted the people to serve on the underground, and we know that for a fact, lots of those guys, the London Transport, British Railway. And I should say that John Richards, the guy on the right with the pinstripes suit, he joined British Rail in 1948. Right when it was nationalized, and he actually retired. He retired as a railway man. He did engineering and helped to repair the train. Okay, let's move on. Now it's important to note this. All right, whom do we call the Windrush generation? That is very important. I showed you a picture just now with the men and women on the ship. They were the pioneering members of the that generation. And therefore, we see them as primary in terms of our story. Now, those who are coming after, those who are coming, let's say 1948, the orbiter, you had a lot of people coming on that particular ship. You have another ship coming afterwards in the 650s. You had Ascania and all kinds of different ships, Arapenia and Venezuela. Now, here are two young people, possibly at that time, maybe what, 9, 10, 11, we don't really know. They would be the ones who are
Michael caught, focus
right. They would be the ones who would be caught up, if so, in the Windrush scandal. All right, don't consider the men and women on the ship, because they will have passed on to glory land. All right, John is 95, and a lot of people, you know, who are on the ship have passed away. Sam King has passed away. My friend Alan Wilmers has passed away. They are of the pioneering. Windrush generation. Whereas these young people here, these two would have been 9, 10, but now they would be pensioners, right? And the Windrush scandal has affected those who came on the parents' passport, can't find the parents' passport, don't have evidence about the scan, you know, about to prove nationality or status. They have had problems, right? And more than, I don't know, it could be 15 to up to 50,000 people were like that. We don't know. Up to now, the Home Office has only identified about, say, 15,000 who could be compensated, something like £333 billion were set aside to pay those who are going to claim compensation for things like false imprisonment, deportation, loss of work, loss of houses, all kinds of different things, loss of health service facilities. This country has to repay these people all of that money, but somehow at the moment, only a fraction of this money has been repaid. But anyway, let's move on because I've only got like 20 minutes. Now, I'm pulling this slide through, not that it's about Guyanese, but it's because it's an important story. The guy who's standing there on your very left, standing there with his hands in pocket, his name is Harold Phillips. His Calypsonian name was Lord Woodbine. And in those days, in the late 1950s, he was the first mentor of the Beatles. Were it not for him, right, we don't know whether there would have been the Beatles, a group called the Beatles. He was the first one with his friend Alan Williams to have taken them to Hamburg. Now, if you hear the Beatles performing in Hamburg, you wouldn't recognize the noise. But even so, those were the early days when John Lennon isn't in this particular image there, the photograph on your right. Paul McCartney is. To McCartney's left, you've got George Harrison and some of the others who actually didn't remain in the group, and so on. So, and then Harold Phillips is seated there, and to your right, you have Alan Williams and you have his wife. You see? So somebody is coming in with music. Somebody is to turn off.
Yeah, fuck you, niggas. You fucking cotton pickers.
Please get that fool out.
Cotton pickers, black coons.
Mercio, shame on you.
Cry out.
You need to unmute Arthur.
Oh, yes. Somehow I was muted. But yes, I was saying that if we can get back to the slide before, where we have Harold Phillips, then we would, I'd be able to continue just briefly, because I shan't be long. So if we can get back up that particular, there are only a few more slides left. Right, I'll tell you what, let's move on. Leave it there for the time being. This is a particular event at St. James Palace, the 50th anniversary of Empire in Rush, the arrival. And here is Prince Charles meeting the men who came on the ship, the pioneers. And among them, I talked to you just now about Edwin Ho. Edwin Ho is the one, the guy there on your very left, as a young man. And Edwin Ho is the guy here in the big picture with Prince Charles. You can tell him, he obviously of Chinese heritage, and here he's waiting to have a chat and a shaking of hands with Prince Charles. Let's unmute everybody on the ship. Okay, that's good. I'm going to repeat that one. On your left, you've got this is Edmund Hall as a young man, sporting, was a very, shall I say, a very interesting gentleman, a boxer. I'm going to come to that very soon. And here he's standing, second left, and he's looking on to shake his hands. Again, Prince Charles wanted to meet these men and women in terms of, you know, they served king and country, and this was important. Most of them there have served in the war. Even this gentleman here, he's no longer with us. His name is, I can't remember his surname, but he had a name similar to mine, Arthur. This gentleman, to your very right, and the one second right is Donald Clark. And all the other men are important. All right, let's go to the next one. We're gonna finish this off very soon.
Sorry, Arthur, hold on.
Okay. Right, again, you've got, you've got Donald Clark to your very left. And then you have a gentleman here, Mr. Mason, who is next to him. He's a shorter one. And then Sam King, a very important figure in this country in terms of Windrush. He actually had the first Windrush commemoration in 1988 in Brixton, the home of Windrush. You know, the first Windrush, I should say, community. 1988, hosted by the mayor of Lambeth. And to your very right, this gentleman passed away a couple of weeks ago. A good friend of mine, very, very close, Alan Wilmot. All right. Again, they all served king and country in the last war. Let's go. Next one. And now we have Edmund Hall and family. All right. So that's easy to say. And next one. We have Edmund Hall again, young man, boxer. As a man of only 5'5", he used to beat them up, whether black or white, or Chinese or Asian, he would beat them up because he was a good boxer. But he never really became professional, and he almost said that he regretted it, but that's another matter for the history books. Here he is, obviously, in the middle. Here he is now as a more, in the 70s or 80s, I'm not sure, no, in the 70s, still trying to pose as a boxer. But he seemed to have been good. Go on the net, there's a video on the net showing him. This is Harold Simpson and family to your very top left. Harold Simpson again with his wife and three daughters. And I knew these people, you know, that's the thing about it. These people who came on the ship, they married various local people, and I actually knew them and interviewed them, which was very important to know. Next one. And that's the end, really. I don't have any more. I didn't say very much about Donald Clark, because again, he came back on the ship. He came back for a job. The job was already there for him. And he came back on ship because some of these men actually went back home on holidays. All right. And they couldn't get a ship back home, home being England. They couldn't get a ship back to England, and they had to wait. Unfortunately, the Empire Windrush came. And from what I know from friends who were on the ship, the ship started out at Tilby Docks, all right? Then to Southampton, then to Trinidad, then to Jamaica, then to Cuba, then to Mexico, back to Cuba, as some people have said to me, to get water, and from Cuba to Bermuda. All right, so that's the itinerary. It did not come from Australia, as you may well see on the internet. So there are loads of actual rubbish and misrepresentations and wrong stories on the internet. But there again, you know, they don't come to the source that actually has the information and has the archive to do with the Empire Windrush. So that is my go, Vanita, and no doubt later on, I can take questions.
Thank you very much for that, Arthur. And I'm just going to stop sharing the screen there. Apologies, everyone, for the interruptions with that. That is why we're so pernickety about people showing what their names are. Just so that people understand, we really need to see your name so that we can check them against the people that have registered. Arthur, thank you so much for that. It was so important, I think, because we often think of the Windrush ship as just being primarily male, and the you know, most of the time people quote that figure, 492 Jamaicans, yes. You know, and forever is quoted. I still see it in the newspapers sometimes. So I think it was really important that you pointed out that there were even Polish people on the ship. There were even, I think you said there were 9 nurses on the ship. I know there was roughly 200 or so women on the ship. Yes,
that's right. I think 292 women.
292, exactly. So, and the total figure, as far as I know, is somewhere in the region
1,027 plus stowaways.
Exactly. So,
I don't know how many.
And 44 Guyanese, as Rod always likes to remind me, because one of his ancestors also arrived on that ship.
That's right.
So that was really fantastic. We'll come to the questions at the end, but for now. Can we just raise our hands together and say thank you so much to Arthur for that?
Okay, thank you.
And then in the meantime, we're going to move on to Claudia. So Claudia, bear with me while I give you co-hosting. So I'm guessing you have a PowerPoint. So I just want to go in and give you co-hosting. Right, so here we go. Make co-host. That's it. We'll come out of that. Okay, so I'm going to give you a formal introduction. So Claudia was born in London, but brought up in Stuartsville, Guyana, and later in London. She has written for various outlets, including the Huffington Post UK and the Independent Voices, History Matters Journal, and Stabroek News. An anti-racist campaigner and creative writer, she has published the novelette Kite Your Sky. She has completed a short biography of Jessica Huntley as a master's degree project and is currently completing a PhD at the University of Chichester entitled Jessica Huntley, A Political History of Radical Black Activism in British Guyana and Britain, 1927 through to 2013. So over to you, Claudia, and a very warm welcome. Thank you.
Thanks very much for that introduction, Juanita. And hello, everyone. As Juanita has said, I am currently partway through my PhD, and today's presentation is based on my PhD research. For my research, I've conducted 36 oral history interviews based on associates who knew Jessica from the 1940s, and family, friends, published authors, and associates right through her entire life and career. For this presentation, I'm going to focus on the first 30 years of her life, which was spent in Guyana. Now, there is some audio on this presentation, so I hope that will work, and we'll see how that goes. So yes, Jessica Huntley was born in 1927 in British Guyana, which became Guyana following independence. And she was reared in a nation founded on the bedrock of racialization, oppression, and exploitation to enrich Britain, its mother country. Despite growing up in deprivation and poverty, she rose to become an influential fighter for her country's liberation from colonial domination. And she also fought for the empowerment of women. After migrating to Britain, she became the co-founder of one of the first independent Black publishing houses in the modern era and a leading radical intellectual reformer and activist. Now, on the next slide, I do have some audio of, you'll hear Jessica speaking, hopefully, if the technology works. She was interviewed in 2010 by George Kelly about her childhood. And so there should be a little audio on the next slide.
My mother definitely in the neighborhood. So she knows her home, she does not know. What woman they hear, this is my mother, they know it's up. She's my brother. That it must take care of me because I'm the only sister and I'm the only girl and the last and all that. There was no father, so my mother brought the 4 of us up. And I think I had more or less a happy childhood as a young girl. I want to think that to look back, to reflect, I didn't think that I had a lot of things. But whatever I had, I was happy with it. I went to school, and my mother, I grew up when I came down to Georgia. I grew up in a tenement yard. And my mother would say all the time that I am growing up in a tenement yard, but I'm not part of the tenement yard. And it's only growing older, even younger, that I realized what she was saying. Because I don't know if you know tenement yard, but that particular one that I grew up with was rough, extremely rough. They were parents beating up the children.
Okay, yeah, so Jessica was aged around 4 or 5 years old when the family moved to a tenement yard in Guyana's impoverished and overcrowded capital city, Georgetown. This followed the death of her father, which plunged the family of 4 children and a mother into poverty. They all lived in one small room at 35 Howe Street, Charleston, in Georgetown. However, as you've heard, Jessica always spoke very fondly about her childhood and said that she had a very happy childhood despite the poverty and deprivations. Her mother, Hectorine, was the yard matriarch who looked after the welfare and moral well-being of the tenement yard. Her interventions in the tenement yard were charitable, and she regularly donated much of what limited provisions she had almost as soon as she received them. She was called Aunt and addressed as such by everyone, including her children and grandchildren. And Aunt, of course, was a title of respect. With her strong Christian beliefs, she saw it as her godly duty to correct all immorality and wrongdoing in the yard and protect her children, especially her daughter, from falling into any traps. So Jessica grew up in that environment and very much understanding how families could bind together, work together, and support each other in a community. She grew up with 3 brothers, Robert, the eldest, the severe disciplinarian, Monroe in the middle, a sociable, happy-go-lucky bodybuilder, and Haddon, the youngest, who she felt very protective towards. Now, Jessica started working in her first job at around the age of 16 or 17, and her first job exposed her to racialization in the workplace. So she worked at Brianna Shirt Factory in Georgetown, not very far from where she lived in Charlestown. And this is one of the images I've managed to find. I don't know if this is the actual shirt factory, but it's certainly an image of the manufacturing, Brianna Manufacturing Company on Lombard Street in Georgetown. She was not offered an office job in the company for which she was qualified, and instead she was put to work on the factory floor with the other Black girls making boxes. She felt that exploitation was built into the working practices and said, "What I saw, they seemed to be so exploitative, what they were doing to those girls." She felt that the workers were made to work harder and faster on the promise of a bonus, but when they were about to reach their target, the conveyor belt would mysteriously malfunction, so they didn't receive their bonuses. She suggested a strike, which the workers agreed to, and she became part of that walkout. It was in a non-unionized setting. The strike had limited impact, and after Jessica was identified as one of the strike organizers, she was eventually sacked for her role as a ringleader. But her leadership drew attention of the local trade unionists, and she was invited to, and she spoke at a meeting of the Sawmill Workers Union.
Claudia, can I just pause a second?
Yes.
I've got a message in there from Alexander the Great. I'm not sure what it means, but he says, can you please show the pictures? Because when Claudia says things like the one on the left, we do not see anyone. Are there slides being missed? I'm not sure what he's referring to.
Hello, I'm here. Sorry, it's just
You may have been referring to this slide, Arthur. So I was talking about the I might be able to use my
We're not seeing the whole slide. You're moving the page now. So half the slide wasn't in view for me. Never mind.
Can you see it now?
Yeah, there's still only half of I can see some of the left-hand side, most
Alexander,
one, and then half of the other one. So I don't know if it's my screen.
Yeah, it might be your screen. If you go to the top right-hand corner, you know there's a thing that says view in the top right-hand
corner. I've got view, yeah.
And then you can have standard or side-by-side or gallery. Play around with that and just see.
Yeah, I've done it. No, you're right. I've put standard in now. Sorry about that, folks.
That's all right. No problem.
I've got it now. Thank you so much. Sorry, folks.
Juanita, can you see all of the slides?
I can see everything. Yeah, that's why I was confused by the message. But thank you. Go ahead.
Thank you. So, Alexander, I was just referring to the brothers. When I said the one on the left, I was just referring to the individual brothers.
I understand. Thank you.
Okay, so love and revolution. It was around 1948 that Jessica was walking home in Georgetown following an evening class. She was carrying her books when a stranger, a young man on a bicycle, stopped and started walking beside her. Eric Huntley, 2 years younger, at age 20 years of age, struck up a conversation with Jessica. The son of a prison warder who had been based in New Amsterdam, a provincial town, had recently returned to Georgetown following his father's posting back to the capital city. After gaining her confidence, she permitted him to escort her home to the tenement room at Howe Street, where she called out her mother to greet him. And this was the start of a relationship that was to last for over 65 years until Jessica passed away. Both Jessica and Eric became members and activists of the emerging People's Progressive Party of Guyana. And on the 1st of January 1950, they both attended and were part of the first meeting of the PPP with a group of political activists, including its leader, Chedi Jagan, and Yusi Kweyana, who also became an official of the party and the first government. And this meeting was at the Metropole Cinema in Buxton, and they founded the new party, which was inaugurated at that meeting. They married in 1950 and had their first son, Carl, in 1951, and their second son, Chauncey, was born in 1952. The couple remained very active in campaigning for the People's Progressive Party, which then went on to win the general election in April 1953. They lived in Buxton, which was a center of community and political organizing by African descended population. They moved to Rossignol on the west bank of the Berbice River and continued their campaigning, both making speeches across the country and amassing huge support for the PPP. After only 6 months in power, the British government overthrew the newly elected PPP government, accusing it of forming a dangerous communist state. It introduced a state of emergency, which resulted in an era of political repression of the PPP. And my research has taken me to the British archives, where there are many records of that period of repression. And I don't know how well you can actually see this document, but it does refer to individuals, including Rory Westmus, Martin Carter, and others who were arrested and imprisoned during that period of time. The fight for women's equality and justice. So in 1953, Jessica was part of a small group of women that included Janet Jagan, who was the wife of Chedi Jagan and who became a leading executive of the party and eventually president of Guyana. Jessie Burnham, Jane Phillips Gay, who all established the new women's section of the PPP called the Women's Progressive Organization. And Jessica was installed as its general secretary. She brought an international perspective to women's liberation, educating and drawing their attention to the position and experience of women in communist and socialist regimes. She wrote several articles for the PPP's journal, Thunder, on the theme of women's empowerment. And what you can see on the slide are various articles from Thunder, which indicate Jessica's activities and her reports, and the fact that she, as party organizer, she regularly visited the population, making speeches and drawing up support for the campaign. Part of one of Jessica's articles written in Thunder about encouraging women to become more empowered, she wrote, in other parts of the world, women are spearheading the attack against imperialists and oppression. They demand equal rights, equal pay for equal work, and equal opportunities for employment. In the metropolitan and war-ridden countries, they are the chief fighters for peace. Mothers are waging a ceaseless and successful war against the butchery that is being prepared by the capitalists in America, England, and France, whose profits depend on the manufacture of deadly weapons. The report into the women of the Robertson Commission, which sought to provide justification for the overthrow of the democratically elected government, included what it considered examples of communist literature, and one of Jessica's articles in Thunder was quoted in that Robertson report, which was presented to Parliament. And the section of Jessica's article that was quoted in that report said, on the other hand, in the USSR, China, and Hungary, in brief, the countries which are not bound by the chains of colonialism and imperialism, the rights of women are guaranteed by their governments and written in the law. That was from Women and Peace by Jessica Huntley, published in June 1953. Britain branded ideas of colonialism, anti-imperialism, workers' rights, and women's liberation as dangerous and as justification for overthrowing the government. By selecting Jessica's article as an example of such danger posed to its interests, she was highlighted as a leading intellectual and fighter for British Guyana's liberation. The WPO also organized resistance activities during the period of resistance, which was a significant risk. As an activist during this period, it's likely that Jessica would have been amongst the WPO, Women's Progressive Organization's activists who employed subterfuge as part of the ongoing campaign against the colonial repression in the country. Research by Roberta Walker Kilkenny found that, and I quote, the women of the WPO undertook the clandestine distribution of party literature and messages, using no disguise save that of a Guyanese woman going to market. These women carried hundreds of illegal pamphlets in their baskets. Messages were delivered as well and funds raised. Though the colonial authorities were soon aware some resistance network was developing, the police and soldiers generally paid little attention to the women that passed by. Following Britain's overthrow of the government in 1953 and the establishment of emergency regulations, the former PPP politicians were denounced to the nation and viewed as subversive. Many were imprisoned, including Chedi Jagan. As a postman and politician, and then a general general counsel of the PPP, Eric Huntley was a person of interest to the security services. The family home was raided by the British Army personnel on a number of occasions, seizing the Gestetner typesetting and duplicating machine, which they had purchased when they were living in Buxton for producing a newsletter for post office union members. Eric, rebellious and angered, continued his activism despite his restriction order. In Soestdyke, he organized a demonstration against the emergency regulations, and along with three or four others involved in the protest, he was arrested and held overnight on Atkinson Air Base. The next morning, the detained prisoners were taken to court in Georgetown, and Eric was charged and convicted and sentenced to 8 months in prison. As part of the campaign of civil disobedience being run by the PPP, he declined any defense in court. From court, Eric was taken directly to Georgetown Prison and served an 8 month prison sentence from September 1954, including a period in solitary confinement. His punishment was made more burdensome by the fact that his father was a prison warder there and had to endure the sight of his son in prison every day. The news agency Reuters reported on the frequent incidents of arrest and imprisonment of the PPP leaders and officials during the period of Britain's repression. And they reported, as you can see on the slide, Huntley, Georgetown, British Guyana. Eric Huntley, a People's Progressive Party member and an official of the country youth organization, was sentenced to 6 months imprisonment today for holding illegal meetings. Another member, Birchill Aaron, was also sentenced to 4 months on a similar charge. Passing sentence, the magistrate said, "It is clear the youth organization formed by Huntley and Aaron was indoctrinating the ignorant masses in conscious propaganda to undermine and to create disaffection in the district." Huntley was also sentenced to 2 months for resisting arrest. The magistrate ordered the sentences to run consecutively. In Soestdyke, on the day of Eric's arrest at the demonstration, Jessica was made aware of what had happened, but was powerless to act. As he had been imprisoned, Eric was inevitably sacked from his job, and Jessica, with Carl and Chauncey, then aged 2 and 3 years old, were evicted from the post office accommodation. She returned to Howe Street, Charleston, her childhood home, to live with Mother Hectorine with her two small children, whilst Eric languished in prison. History had repeated itself, and she found herself traumatically moving from a comfortable home back to the tenement yard. The events of Soestdyke meant that the lives of Jessica and Eric, to quote Eric, were completely torn asunder. But her commitment to political change wasn't dampened, and there was no question of her feeling any shame at her husband's imprisonment. On the contrary, she held her head high, to quote Eric, visiting him in prison and keeping him abreast of events. When Eric was released from prison, he found himself barred from civil service jobs, and his only option was to travel abroad to Britain, and he left in December 1956. There was an intensification of Jessica's political activism following that, and she became the organizing secretary for the PPP in 1957. And at that time, she was also fielded for a seat in government as a woman activist, with its manifesto describing her as an officer of the women's section of the PPP, actively campaigned for the party in 1953 elections, one of the founding members of the women's political organization, an ardent fighter for peace and freedom in British Guyana for the rights of women and children. Unfortunately, Jessica was fielded in a safe seat for another party, and the seat that was also contested by a splinter faction of the PPP after it had split. So she did not win that seat. Eric in England at this time sent her word of commiseration on her election defeat, saying, "I can only guess how tired and disappointed you are now. It's all over. One thing is uppermost in my mind, and I would like you to put it at rest. Will you be joining your husband? And must I go ahead making plans?" He was therefore very keen to persuade Jessica to join him in England. Torn by what she was leaving behind, including her two young sons and her beloved mother and wide circle of friends and her political activism, Jessica finally made the decision to leave, and she started her preparations to leave British Guyana for the mother country in 1957. She arrived in 1958. On the next slide, I have a recorded extract, just a few seconds, of one of my interviews with one of my participants who was inspired by Jessica and speaks about her legacy.
Which finds solution and then realizing that it's gonna take quite a long time. So before it's too hard to be in a position to say, wherever you are, Jessica, that we heard you, we did what you were asking for. We'll continue to do it. And you, in your name, you'll be remembered for being the strong African Black woman, which you've always been. And we appreciate it. And we're grateful for having had your company. So thank you, Jessica.
And my final slide, I acknowledge, I present a list of acknowledgements for this section of my research. Thank you very much.
Oh, wonderful, Claudia. Thank you so much. That was an awesome presentation. Absolutely brilliant. And I'm delighted as well. I can see that Uncle Eric is actually online with us today. So that's just even more wonderful because Rod was saying to me in the background about, you know, you talked about the young man on the bicycle and Rod saying, but what was his father thinking all the time? Because, you know, when Uncle Eric was in prison, his father was the prison warden, I think, or something like that. So I'm sure we'll have some interesting questions for you afterwards. But yeah, really appreciate it, Claudia. Thank you. That's just for those who have their screens on, I'm just doing a clap to say thank you on their behalf, Claudia. But we're going to move on now to John Rickford. John, are you there? Can you unmute? Let me see if I can find John. I don't know if John... hang on.
Here he is.
He
just sat down.
Okay, so John should be online shortly.
Yes, I am.
There you are. Fantastic. Good. Thank you so much for joining us, John.
Thank you.
I'm just going to introduce you formally, and then I'll bring up your slides.
Okay.
Guyanese born and raised, John Rickford is the J. E. Wallace Sterling Professor of Linguistics Emeritus at Stanford University. His research interests include ethnicity, social class, style, variation and change, educational linguistics, creolistics, and African American vernacular English. He is married to Angela Marshall, also Guyanese and a retired professor. John's books include Dimensions of a Creole Continuum, History, Text, and Linguistics, Linguistic Analysis of Guyanese Creole, that's 1987, and Variation and Change in Sociolinguistics and Creole Studies, 2019. We're going to be putting some information about John's talk in the chat section, so just keep an eye out on that. I'll be including John's webpage, and my understanding, he's going to be sharing some excerpts from his memoir, Speaking My Soul, Race, Life, and Language, which is forthcoming in December. So keep an eye out on that. We'll be providing information about that on the Guyana Speaks Facebook page. But for now, I'm going to switch over to John. I'm just going to share the screen first, which I believe is this one. Hold on a second. I had three different ones up, so I just need to sort out my own desktop.
That was it. It was only half of it, though.
Yes, you could say, I know exactly. That's why it's like I needed to open it right up. I'm just going to do that. And bear with me. Share screen. I think it's this one here. And then I need to, there we go, perfect. So yes, let me know when I need to start turning, moving the pages, but over to you, John, and a very warm welcome.
Thank you. Change the slide, please.
Yeah.
Change.
There we go.
So I wanted to thank Juanita and Rod for this kind invitation. And I want to cover today three different but related Black history topics. First of all, the flying back to Africa motif, which occurs in the story of Guyanese Donald Skeet. But I'm going to do it from a comparative perspective. Oops, from the US and parts of the Caribbean and African diaspora. Then I want to touch on three cases in which I touched the hem of Black history. Rosa Parks, Dennis Brutus, and Rachel Jontel, who was a good friend of Trayvon Martin, whose killing sparked the Black Lives Matter. And finally, I will turn to Black talk in Guyana and the Caribbean and its systematicity and significance. Next slide. Yes, so Donald Skeet is a person I recorded in 1978, pretty ordinary Guyanese. In fact, one of the most important people I've ever recorded are ordinary, regular people. He's from Cumberland, near the Kanji River in New Amsterdam. His great-grandfather, Roger Stroot, was a slave from Guinea, from the Popo tribe. I suspect there are very few people who can tell you what tribe their ancestors came from. His great-aunt, who raised him from birth, told him about his great-grandfather and the story he had told her about flying back to Africa. And this is in my 1987 book. Next slide. So he said he was brought down in a yacht. He said, when I say yacht, a boat, a sailing boat. Many of them in the night, during the night, they were put on the deck. But during the day, they were down in the hatch. When the night is cool and they're on the deck, they used to have a pastime. So I said, eh? What do you used to do? He said, sit around in a ring. Ring play. Then they start to sing, you know, sing in their country way. When they sing for time, one out of the circle will sit in the middle of the ring. Then the tempo comes greater and greater and greater and greater, and he just disappeared. Gone back, man, gone back to Africa. He actually added that after a while, the crew realized that the slaves were disappearing, and they kept them down in the hatch and wouldn't let them come out on top anymore. So this at first seemed, next slide, it seemed like a bit of family folklore, but his story recurs in African America. So in a wonderful book called The People Could Fly by Virginia Hamilton, you get this little excerpt. He said, the driver come and whipped him. Toby come over and spoke African words, kum kum ka yali, kum tambe, and he flew away. He cried out to the fallen, and they too rose on the air. The ones flying were black and shining sticks, wheeling over the headed overseer. They crossed the roads, the fields, the fences, the streams, and were away. Mm-hmm. It occurs also in Song of Solomon by Toni Morrison, the little refrain here, oh, Sugarman done fly away, Sugarman gone home, Sugarman cut across the sky, Sugarman gone home. Next slide. But I first heard a similar story way back in 1970 from Francis Jones of the Frusky Islands, South Carolina, the Sea Islands. I've been living and working with Frank Smith on the Sea Islands for about 10 weeks. And she told me that her great-grandparents flew back to Africa, not again, after receiving a whipping. Okay? There are also several stories of drums and shouters with similar stories from this area. Next slide. Drums and Shouters, a book that's based on stories from the Sea Island Creole, very similar to what Mrs. Jones and people from the Frusky Island spoke. Let me give you just two. So from Sapelo Island, Georgia, Shad Hall said, those folks could fly too. They tell me there's a lot of them. The master was fixing the time up to whip them. They say, master, you ain't going to lick me. And with that, they run down to the river. The overseer, he so thought he could catch up when they get down to the river. But before he could get to them, they rise up in the air and fly away. They fly right back to Africa. I think that happened on Butler Island. And from St. Simon's Island, Ben Sullivan said, I hear plenty of Africans talk of flying. There's plenty of them what could fly. Next slide. So there are parallels also in the Caribbean, apart from Guyana. So Suriname, Petronella Breinberg on the left, has a book called Legends of Suriname about people who could fly. And in fact, she added that people who ate pork lost the ability to fly. So that was built into the idea. And then there's this amazing book by Miguel Barnett, biography of a runaway slave, about Esteban Montejo, the Cuban runaway slave whose biography he narrated. Now, Esteban didn't realize slavery was ended until he was found hiding in the forest sometime later. He said that African slaves didn't escape slavery by suicide, as some said, but by flying. They flew to the sky and returned to their own lands. He added that the Musundi Congolese flew the most, and they disappeared by means of witchcraft, by fastening a chain to the wrist, which was full of magic. I know all this intimately, he said, and it is true without a doubt. So what's the deeper significance of this flying motif? Well, my good friend, late friend, Wordsworth Bacandrew, noted, of course, the parallels with Old Hag, who flies through the air in search of victims. The Jamaican writer Maureen Warner Lewis discussed in The Flying Back the Africa motif, which occurs also in Jamaica, and the belief that slaves who were being beaten could have their hurt telepathically transferred to the slave master's wife. Wonderful solution. Noted that these events were often induced by incantations of African languages and served as tools of rebellion against slavery. So Maureen Warner Lewis has written a wonderful book about Trinidad Yoruba. Now, it may in part symbolize the fervent desire of Africans to return home, which Monica Schuller talked about in her book, Alas, Alas, Congo, or more importantly, their belief in the transmigration of the soul to Africa after death, which Van Bulken noted way back in 1695, and could also account for slaves running away from slavery. So slaves who ran away from slavery and they disappeared, they would say, well, they flew back to Africa. Next slide. But in any case, Donald Skeet's Flying Back to Africa story should not be dismissed as a bit of family folklore. It's a widespread, pervasive legend within the African-American New World. And to fully appreciate its significance, we need to follow Melville Herskovitz, The Myth of the Negro Past, comparing events in Africa with events in the Caribbean, North America, and Black Europe. So from this perspective, I'll briefly talk about three cases in which this humble son of Guyana was fortunate enough to touch the hem of history: Rosa Parks, Dennis Brutus, and Richard Jantel, before I return to Guyana and Black talk. Next slide. Okay, so here I'll be drawing on my book, Speaking My Soul, which is coming out in December. And I'll draw on the content from chapters 13, 14, 16, and 11, the ones that are highlighted there. Next slide. So we invited in 1990 Rosa Parks to Stanford. Here I am on the left with my wife, Angela, three of our resident assistants who helped us, and then Mrs. Parks' assistant, and Rosa Parks is sitting in a chair right there. Next slide. Now, Mrs. Parks visited us for 2 days, and I take away several points I want to make. First of all, she had no kids but loved children. She was the advisor to the NAACP Youth Council, National Association for the Advancement of Colored People, since 1949. I should add, I've lost my picture of this, but she came to our little cottage for about half an hour before she came to a press conference, and our five-year-old jumped in her lap, and we said, no, you know, the famous Rosa Parks, and she said, please leave him, and she had a wonderful visit with our family. The important point is that she did not refuse to give her a seat in 1955 because she was tired, which is a common myth about Rosa Parks. 4 months before that incident, she'd attended a workshop at Highland at Work School, Tennessee, which was a training site for Southern civil rights activists. Moreover, As she was boarding the bus in 1955, she noted the driver was the same guy who depicted her in 1943 for refusing to leave the bus after paying the fare and re-enter from the back. So apparently what the black people had to do, you go to the front, you pay your fare, you couldn't walk through the white section. You had to leave the bus again and come around the back and then enter. She refused to do that and he threw her off the bus. Okay, notice that's 12 years earlier, but she remembered him very well. And probably the most important point to me was her telling us about this practice they had of driving off as soon as black passengers were about to board. So as you're about to board on the bus, they thought it was very funny to drive off by about 10 or 15 feet. You'd have to run to catch up again. The driver might drive off again 10 or 15 feet. So it was extremely humiliating. And very often youth would complain that they would, you know, they'd pull the cord to be let off, and drivers would ignore them and may leave them off 12 blocks away from where they wanted to go. So these were, there's a long pattern of humiliation and degradation. And she was very politically active. And if she had gotten up and given that seat to accommodate one white person, she and three black passengers would either have to leave or to stand throughout the rest of the trip. Her defiance triggered a Montgomery bus boycott, which ended bus segregation and vaulted Martin Luther King Jr. to national leadership. He was relatively unknown at the time. So thank you, Miss Rosa. You are the spark that started our freedom movement. Thank you, Sister Rosa Parks. This is from the Never Brothers 1989 song, Sister Rosa. So we actually have a recording of the press conference with Rosa Parks, which you're going to get here from the Sanford Library, and we'll put that link in the chat. Okay, next slide. Now, Dennis Bootis. I didn't know about Dennis Bootis before I went to England in the summer of 1990. But of course, he was a central figure in the anti-apartheid movement who campaigned vigorously against racism in sports and was instrumental in getting South Africa banned from the Olympics from 1964 to 1992. He also worked with Nelson Mandela and Walter Sisulu to call for a new constitution, 1961. And he's considered one of Africa's most accomplished poets. I would like to read some poets, but I don't have time for that. So I met him through the Stanford and Oxford program, a program we organized, brought about 35 students to Oxford for the summer of 1990. He gave a lecture to our group, and I stood and I interviewed him afterwards. Next slide, please. So that's a picture of him, Dennis Bootis, and I was introducing him to our Stanford and Oxford program. And we also did a recorded interview with him, which is available at that link. We'll put that in the slide. Next slide. So he became president of the South African Non-Racial Olympic Committee, or SANROC, which opposed the White Olympic Committee, which didn't consider or admit blacks. But they made it a crime for him to attend any meetings. He went to a meeting of SANROC in 1963, was arrested by the South African Secret Police, released on bail, but was confined to Johannesburg and placed under house arrest. Nevertheless, he defiantly tried to attend that 1963 meeting, and he was returned to the South African Secret Police. Now, the next day, it took him to Johannesburg, and they said, well, we're not going to handcuff you because we hope you try to escape. This will give us an excuse to kill you. So there was no handcuff. Next slide. Buddha says, I made a second dash for safety and freedom, assuming they wouldn't shoot in the crowd at 5 o'clock in the afternoon. I was wrong. And I was shot in the back at close range. The bullet entered my back, came out of my chest, and it kept running for a while. Then I stopped. And then the guy who shot me, his name was Helberg, an elderly gentleman with gray hair. Notice, by the way, how respectful he is in describing this man who tried to kill him. He came up to me and I said, hey, I've been shot. And he said, I know, I shot you. There are other things I've left out here. The first ambulance that came, they said they couldn't take him because it was for white people only. he had to wait another half an hour for a black ambulance to come. But he was sentenced to 18 months in Robben Island to the maximum security second for political prisoners. He was in a cell next to Nelson Mandela, and like him, spent his days doing hard labor, breaking rocks, in fact, a very heavy hammer. And he opted, when he came out, for one-way exile to England, then moved to the US. Next slide. 1990, Mandela was freed from prison and became president in 1994. In 1996, 4 years after South Africa was allowed to rejoin the Olympics, by the way, you remember at one point that even the West Indies team tried to break that ban and take a cricket team to South Africa, but that was not allowed. A guy called Josiah Tugwane became the first black South African to win an Olympic gold medal in the men's marathon. Now, actually, Tugwane had started running when apartheid was intact, but in 1988, when non-whites were denied equipment and stock running tracks, he was allowed to train with the running team of the coal mining company where he worked as a janitor. As Mandela said, Tugwane reinforced our pride and confidence as a nation. So he played a very important role in Tugwane's participation in the gold medal ring. Can I see the next slide, I'll show you? This is Tugwane, who actually won the South African Olympics gold medal. In fact, the shortest margin, I think he won by about 3 or 4 seconds, but it was very, very important and significant. Okay, next slide. The third event in which I touched the hem of history was the 2013 trial of George Zimmerman on the left for the killing of Trayvon Martin in Florida. So Martin's death and Zimmerman's acquittal sparked the powerful Black Lives Matter movement. Okay, without that trial, would not have happened. I focus here on Rachel Jontel. Let's go to the next slide, please. Yeah, I wasn't involved in the trial itself, but I became involved with Rachel Jontel, who was Trayvon's good friend, and my wife and I used to help to tutor her in reading. So why is Rachel Jontel significant? Well, first of all, I'm sorry. Let's get back to where we were. Yeah, she has a dialect was very vernacular, similar to Guyanese Creole in some respects. She used on the cell phone with Trayvon Martin throughout his encounter with Zimmerman. So she was the closest thing to Trayvon being in the courtroom himself, which of course he could not be because he was dead. She was a star witness for the prosecution for about 6 hours of testimony. And we have 15 hours of data now from the depositions and from the trial, TV appearances, including some from Zimmerman's defense lawyer, who I suspect had second thoughts about Zimmerman after the case. But jurors complained that they found her hard to understand and not credible. Okay? And despite the centrality of her testimony, no one mentioned her in 16 or more hours of jury deliberations. Her testimony played no role whatsoever in their decision. Next slide. Okay, so here am I and my wife with Rachel Jontel. This was her lawyer, and later on we were tutoring her mainly by Skype, but often when we would go to Miami. Next slide. Okay, I think if you press it again, you should hear it. Click again on it and see if it works.
She's speaking, no sound.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I'm not sure why there's no sound. Juanita, you have your volume on? Okay, it's all right. Go back to that slide.
Sorry, John, I could hear it. I don't know if it could. Anybody else let us know if you could hear it?
No, I couldn't hear it.
You couldn't hear it?
Yeah. Let's go back. Let's look at it a second. If you look at our speech, you'll notice that these zeros represent the areas where things like is and are, apostrophe s, are missing. He said he from, I asked him where he had, he told me he had the back of his daddy fiance house, in the area where his daddy fiance, by his daddy fiance house. I say, better keep running. He said, nah, he lost them. Okay. And later on, he say he, by the area that the daddy fiance house is, and so on and so on. Not only is the language relevant, but Zimmerman was claiming that he was, that Trayvon Martin was chasing him. It was clear from Rachel's testimony that Zimmerman was chasing Trayvon Martin, okay? So let's go to the next slide. Yeah, so the point is that intelligibility and evaluation of language is really shaped to a great extent by our attitudes and our social prejudices, okay? That whether or not something is understood is a function of both the speaker and the hearer. And we have other research that shows that more accented or non-standard English is rated as less credible due to processing difficulties. Okay, let's go to the last section, please. So, how I fell in love with Black Talk. Black Talk is the title of a book by Geneva Silverman called Black Words and Phrases, From the Hood to the Amen Corner. But it's also the title of an older book in 1917 by J. Graham Cruikshank. So I used it to refer to both. But I want to note, of course, that while Black Talk in Guyana was first created and used by enslaved Africans, it was adopted and adapted by East Indian indentured slavers, servants, and Guyanese of other ethnicities. So I also use the term to refer to the Creole Englishes of the Caribbean. Next slide. Next slide. So it's comparable in many ways to a term that Edward Cammell Baffert called nation language, okay? He called it the language of slaves and laborers. He said, nation language is a language which is influenced very strongly by the African model, the African aspect of our New World heritage. It may be English in terms of its words, its lexical features, but in its contours, its rhythm, its timbre, its sung explosions, it is not English, even though the words as you hear them might be English to a greater or lesser extent. It illustrates the point with several examples, including Bekian delivered by the late Jamaican poet, Michael Smith. Next slide, please. Here's a little excerpt from Mr. Bekian, believe it. And let's try the next slide to see if we can actually hear it. Might not work. There's a little play at the bottom of the slide. Oops, we lost it again.
I realize it's my fault. I need to go back into it to connect it to the audio so that the audience can hear it. So I'm just going to go back in.
Okay.
And you'll. I'm going to put share sound on and then we should be able to hear it. So.
Okay. I wouldn't keep you all too much longer because I know you want to talk about all these things and about other excellent presentations.
I lost it. Did I lose it?
Yes, there it is.
Is this one? Okay, good.
Yeah.
Let's go.
Ah.
Semi can't believe it.
Ah,
semi can't believe it. Room them a rent me apply within. But as me going cockroach, rotten scorpion also come in. One good nose of a run. But me now got a stump on high wall like Humpy Dumpy. Me, I face my reality. One little boy come blow him on, and me look upon him with scorn. As me realize, some five boy Pickney was a victim of the trick them called partisan politics. And me ban me belly and me ball. And me ban me belly and me ball. Lord, me can't believe it.
Thank you.
Next slide.
Sorry.
That's all right. Next slide. Oops.
I don't know why. Hold on. Here we go.
Okay.
It didn't want to come out.
Okay. I got it. I have it. You know, I should add, by the way, that actually Michael Smith was stoned to death because of the same partisan politics that he mentioned. But I want to hear Anna from Boston. Okay. Let me try play.
Thing bad. Nothing selling at this market. Every man you got to wake up 3 o'clock long time, thing used to sell. Now it's worse. People ain't want to buy nothing. I just tell them how the price going. They say, thing there, eat there, shopping there, marketing there, all thing there. Nothing I sell. Right? Me come out from boxing. Right? Me attack the truth. Nothing I sell.
Okay. So again, you can see the pervasiveness of repetition for dramatic effect, not nasal, think deary dear. But note the variation in grammatical form from the more urban, not nenselen, to the more rural, not nasal. Next slide. Oh, sorry. And then note the deep Creole use of me as a pronoun subject, which contrasts with the more urban English-like use of I or R, which occurs elsewhere, for instance, when Anna is talking about bicycle thefts. The last bicycle I lasted there, I take it out for 3 months, okay? Finally, note that plurals are unmarked most of the time in Anna's speech, thing bad, 3 months, but when needed, they can be marked with English S or Creole them, the thing them or them thing. In short, Anna has a vast arsenal, a wide array of grammatical resources with which she expresses herself. Next slide. Okay, this is Granny. I'm going to try to play this on another recorder.
How do you work so hard? You're throwing yourself at the bank and you sell a lot of really stuff that's ever come out of me. You better be dead before me leave.
Okay. Granny's very eloquent words recall David Aberdeen's song of the Creole Gang Women, Enslaved Song, in capturing the endless pain of the Chicago street worker. Pain, nothing but pain. 1,000,000,000 acre pain. Oh, since we born, juk, 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 juk. So sun in me eye like tan. Next slide. So as a linguist, I have hundreds and hundreds of recordings of people like Anna and Granny from Guyana, the West Indies, US, and elsewhere. Next slide. And what do I do as a linguist? What did I do over my career? So I would analyze these recordings to show that Guyanese, Creolese, like all languages, is systematic and rule governed. I'll give a little explanation there, but I can explain more if you want. In 1971 to 1996, so probably the first 25 years, I also focus on historical issues. Was African-American vernacular English once a Creole? What was the history of Creolese in Guyana, and so on? But for this last 25 years, I focus more on applied issues like literacy, jobs, criminal justice, and how these are affected by one's dialect. I saw this in the Opening Ebonics issue of 96, 97, and in Jean-Tel's vital testimony about Trayvon Martin, which was ignored because it was in deep African-American vernacular English. Similar complications have arrived in court cases where I made depositions. And I think actually on my webpage, I have a link to a 2016 paper that I wrote about this issue with Trayvon Martin. So in many ways, Jamaica is doing much more than Guyana with respect to applications led by a Guyanese, Hubert Devenish. At University of Guyana, Alim Hussein and Charlene Wilkerson are commendedly trying to do more. Brown, Blake, and Roberts noted that the Jamaican Creole person said, we drop a gong and then we start run, was mistranscribed in the United Kingdom as I dropped the gun and then I ran, which of course is totally different, makes him culpable, whereas he was making a very innocent statement. Cornel West said, justice is what love looks like in public, just like tenderness is what love feels like in private. And I said in my book, love is not love. Many people say, oh, I love Creolese and so on, if it does nothing to enhance the lives of those we love. So my question is, do people who say thing bad, or he better me dead before me I live, get the same justice and develop the same level of literacy in Guyana, not to mention the UK and United States, as those who speak standard English? I mean, I know, but I suspect not. I want to note that I also favor helping all those who want to master standard English to do so, but I also support justice and fairness for the vernacular speakers of Creolese. So if my last point is that the same way in which a comparative perspective helps us understand Skeet's Flying Back to Africa's story, a comparative perspective helps us to understand what's happening with the Creole language and justice and literacy elsewhere in the Caribbean. Thank you. Oh, thanks especially to those who helped me most to transcend my stroke in September 2019 and write my memoir. I wouldn't have written this memoir had I not had my stroke. And in fact, in my prologue, I call it The Gift of Stroke. And my final chapter is called. Okay.
Thank you so much for John. That was so much for that, John, because it was absolutely fascinating. In fact, you reminded me of a man who taught Rod how to drive, because his part-time job was to be a spokesperson for people in the British justice system who spoke using Jamaican patois. For the very reasons that you were talking about there, people's complete misunderstanding of what was being said, you know, and not appreciating the kind of, not appreciating that patois as well was rule governed or, you know, degrading it as a language. But actually, he that was his job. And I didn't even know we had people here in the UK who did jobs like that. So that was... fascinating. But thank you. I'm putting my hands together for you, just in appreciation, as I'm sure our audience do. I'm very conscious, actually. I think before I say anything else, I'm conscious that Arthur Torrington said he had to leave, I think, at about 5 o'clock. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to spotlight all of you on the page so that people can address their questions to you. So let me just see if I can do that now. I don't know why. So stay with us there, John. Let me just bring Arthur on and Claudia. Yeah.
How can I get that?
See if I can do that. Honestly, my computer is misbehaving today, but anyway, it's fine. So Spotlight, Claudia and Arthur is here. There is Arthur. Let's see if I can spotlight Arthur. And there's John. Okay. Did that work? Okay, I need to spotlight John now. I just lost John. Can you see him on there, Rod? Can you help me? He's at the top. Fantastic. So I can just spotlight that. And spotlight. So we should have all three.
Granted.
It worked. Ta-da. Fabulous. Okay. So I don't know who's going to get what questions first. Perhaps Rod, do you want to...
Arthur, since he's asked to leave.
Yes, of course. Let me just have a quick look through the questions in the chat. Arthur, before I address any questions with you, could you say something a little bit about Alan Wilmot? Because I know we very sadly lost... you need to...
Yes, that's a good point. Yeah, well, he passed away a couple of weeks ago. I would say peacefully, because, you know, I asked him about pain, whether he was feeling any pain. Yeah, he had cancer of the bowels.
Right.
Unfortunately, and that was so sudden because we've never, you know, he's never really complained of any pains in the past, but it just shows you that some people could be passing away slowly, and he was one. I mean, he was he would have been 97 next year.
And, yeah,
you know,
no.
And when he passed, you know, well, what should I say? I say a month before he passed. I mean, his memory was just like yours or mine. I have to say that to you.
Absolutely.
And so we lost a man who he served in the Royal Navy, right? Back in the Caribbean, and as you know, the Caribbean was a theater of war in the Second World War. So he served as a 16-year-old. Well, it's nearly 17. And then eventually he came to the UK and served in the RAF. So very few people, you know, from the West Indies have served in the Royal Navy and then served in the RAF. And that's outstanding. And then he came back and he became a singer. He became an entertainer in the Southlanders. You know, Southlanders, a famous hit, you know, I'm a mole and I live in a hole. And he made hits like that, you know, Ain't That a Shame, Fats Domino's song. So you're looking at somebody who was iconic in the UK, you know, played on the London Palladium, like Bob Monkhouse, all the big star, Bruce Forsyth, you named them, Steptoe & Son, if you're old enough, that kind of thing, you know, he actually was involved with the Southlanders. And in fact, his brother, Harry Wilmot, is the father of Gary Wilmot, those of you who know entertainment.
Thank you for that, Arthur. Yes, Gary Wilmot looks very much like Alan Wilmot as well, actually. There's a very strong family resemblance. They obviously are a very creative family, but
yes,
the last time I saw Alan Wilmot wasn't that long ago, and he looked as well as ever.
Yeah, he was good. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I was really quite surprised to hear when he passed, but and very sorry too, because he always had that really positive energy about him.
Always positive, you know, down to the end, he was positive.
Yes, yes. So I have a question here. If I can read the handwriting, which is my husband's, and it's terrible. I'm just trying to. He says the Windrush statue is set to be unveiled shortly. Rod, please read this.
Yeah. I can't read it. You read it.
Sorry, I can't read my husband's writing.
Yeah, I can predict the question. About the Windrush statue. I mean, is it a statue in Waterloo Station or in Hackney?
Yeah.
The one in Waterloo Station.
Waterloo Station. Again, this particular monument is more than it's a monument. It's been imposed by the government. And I think this is what we must realize. How can a statue or a monument be imposed on a community? And that is completely wrong, and we're going to be protesting about it, possibly having a march or having some kind of demonstration at Waterloo Station. So it's an imposition.
Right? Who's on the committee, Arthur? Because
the committee, I saw
Fluella Benjamin was on there.
Yeah, she runs the committee, and that is what she wants.
I see. Okay.
Yeah. Okay. And the government is behind.
But they're being funded by the government, essentially.
Yes, it's sponsored by them, and they're pushing it through in a forceful way because there was no consultation with the community.
Okay. None.
To do with Waterloo Station.
Yes, yes. So thanks for sharing that, Arthur. I can't see any questions. Okay. In the chat. I don't know if anyone has got any questions. As I say, please use the reactions button. One question I have for you, Arthur, though, about the actual Windrush ship. What I've always found fascinating is the representations that we see in the media of that, the arrival in 1948. And I'm just trying to understand how come we don't see any of the Polish refugees. You know, all the images are of just men that I've seen.
Yeah.
I've certainly never seen the refugees or even the real diversity, the children that were on that ship or the women. And I'm wondering why? Is it because of we don't have the archival you know, access to the archives, or was it just the media? That's what they were interested in.
It's about the media. Yeah, the media were looking at the men, especially those who came back to serve king and country. But if you, there are some video footage, and you could see women on the, you know, coming into Tilby docks. Women just walking along into the actual docks itself. So yeah, so you do see women, but not still photographs. You don't see this as much as the men. But yes, indeed, but they are footage of the women. But it's a bit of a bias really about that really, because see, this is how the government portrayed it, that there were 492 Jamaican men coming over. And that really sent the media, you know, really up in the air, really. And when in reality, that was not the case.
Yeah, so essentially what they were concerned about was the arrival of Jamaicans. They weren't really worried that other people had arrived on that ship. And it's interesting because I sort of feel that focus has never left the Jamaican community. We see, like in the Windrush scandal, that the vast majority of people who've been affected by it have been Jamaicans, but also in terms of the deportations, they seem really set on some sort of, I don't know, there doesn't seem to be any government will to put right what has been wrong about this Windrush scandal. I don't know what your view is on that, Arthur.
Yeah, well, at least they say they're trying. And I mean, it's not, I don't think it's easy as to what they're doing, right. Because if you know how civil servants work, it's usually slower than normal. And this is what's going on about the compensation. Something like a third of £1 billion have to be dished out, and they're not even maybe 10 or 20% there yet. So they may be willing, I mean, this is what they say, but it's not happening. And Jamaican men especially get a lot of publicity because the media prefers that, you see. For example, I remember there was a Trinidadian woman of Asian heritage that didn't get enough publicity because she had a similar issue, and eventually she won through and got the status. And that just got through, you know. Somehow Jamaican men seem to me to be what the media people like to publicize.
No, that's very true. It's a bit like when they're talking about knife crime in the Black community. You know, they're always focusing on knife crime in the Black community without ever pointing out that they have the same levels of knife crime problems in Glasgow, for example, in the white community. So yes, I certainly take your point there.
Yeah, those two, for example, also they love to focus on Nigerian men. And so Jamaicans and Nigerians, they get the publicity each time, whereas everything else is just played down. Downwards.
Yes. So there's a message in the chat from Chandra that I don't fully understand. So forgive me, Chandra, if I'm not saying it the right way, but it says VIP treatment, UNESCO event, when we had to evacuate the building because of an electric fire in the basement. Thank you for making me special.
That's City Hall. Okay.
So I'm glad you know what that's about.
Yeah, City Hall.
She said, put in VIP suite, living the life, bless you. Okay, so that's Chandra saying thank you to you. I think it's a long way around that.
Okay.
So we have a hand up as well from someone who didn't put their name in, but I'm just, if you want, it's you. I'm sorry, I don't know what your name is. It just says, please rename has raised their hand. So if you could raise, if you could please unmute yourself and speak directly.
Yes.
Thank you, Mr. Torrington, who I think I know.
Okay.
Was this deportation not based on color?
Well, it's based, I would say yes, because the origin was color.
Yes, but...
Right? And I'll tell you why
the origin is color. People were seen as different.
Yeah, it is color. Because you see, Clement Attlee, a Labour Prime Minister in 1948, he was the one that began to talk about colored immigration. And by that he meant Indo-Caribbean, Chinese Caribbean, and African Caribbean. he lumped them all together and called it colored immigration or colored immigrants. But I tell you this, you cannot be an immigrant if you have a passport for where you're going. Think about it. You can't be. There were people who were coming over from France to England. Had they had passports, they need not have taken boats over. It's not a fact.
So but I resisted deportation myself.
So I resisted deportation from the West Indies as immigrants.
My question is for the next lady. Thank
that
you.
That was the wrong thing.
I resisted deportation myself. Okay. But my question is for the next speaker, Claudia, when my turn comes. So thank you for bearing with
me. All right.
So the speaker, I'm gonna guess here now because I hear so many people, I recognize them by their voices, and I'm going to take a guess that is Aleph Harewood. Aleph, is that you? Okay, so she's not saying, but it sounded
on,
like
on mute. She hasn't unmuted.
Yes, well, it is. Yes, it is.
Aleph, yes, how is. Wonderful to have you.
It's join wonderful
us.
To be here because. You know, I've been through this journey, as you know. But my question was for Claudia. I went to Stuartville School. I went to Georgetown School. I knew Lombard Street. I knew the Short Factory. I knew the PPC. I knew that activity. I knew when the government was put in jail. I knew the interim government of Guyana. I did that journey. And then I came here, and then I was threatened with deportation when I went to funeral and back. So, you know, I've been there. So your story is in my heart, in my mind, in my life, in my present, in my future, in me.
Thank you.
I knew where this woman lived.
Okay.
I knew Buxton
yeah,
so, well. I lived yeah. in Georgetown.
Thank you. You're welcome. What I would say is that when people arrived, as Jessica and Eric did in the mid-50s, Eric came in 56, Jessica 58, and to kind of in a way connect with Arthur's research, I think people don't realize what a huge trauma people had already gone through before arriving as settlers in Britain, and Guyana's path, as we know, to independence was particularly turbulent, and it was one of the most kind of violent paths to independence of all the Caribbean nations. And by the time people arrived in the late 50s, they had already gone through huge trauma and had leaving their children, uprooting their family, friends, and just trying to make a new life. I think people don't realize what people have left behind, those who are arriving to start new lives.
Thank you for that. Aleph, I'm going to be in touch with you. We have things to talk about.
Ring me sometime, babe. I'm still on this journey.
Fantastic. Thank you so
much. Still on this journey, I promise you.
Okay. Thanks so much, Aleph.
Hands up, Derek.
So, who's that, Rod? Derek?
Derek Thomas.
I'm being told somebody, Derek Thomas, would like to speak. Derek, if you can unmute and share your question.
Yeah, my name is Derek Bobington Thomas. I can also relate to Claudia because I did my apprenticeship at Roots Group in Lambert Street, the Roots Group car department. I came here in 1957 and I came on the TV Venezuela. I went through Paris, Italy, Paris, Calais, then to Dover, then to Victoria Station in 1957, arrived here the 1st of August 1957. But because I did my apprenticeship with the Roots Group car factory there in Lambert Street, I came to the service department here in England, in Ladbroke Grove. And I also did 12 years in the Air Force. I was calling for national service. So I did 12 years in the Air Force. And then I move on to various other jobs as engineers. I work in Holland. I work various parts of the world. I was a brain and body scanner specialist in hospitals around the world. So I used to install CT scanners, X-ray systems, and other hospital diagnostic systems around the world. So I've been here for a long time. Actually, I've been here now for nearly 64 years. And I had the pleasant opportunity of being a torchbearer in the Olding Pits and took part in the opening ceremony. So I have a long history of being in England and overhead by my various problems, but I overcome them by education, good manners, and respect. And this is what I do when I speak to kids in school in my retirement. I generally try to tell them that education opens the door, respect for themselves, respect for their appearance, and it helps graciously because I use this method through my career in England and has been very successful in that way. So I just want to introduce myself as Derek Thomas and Claudia Equiano, Miss Cox.
Yes, yes.
If you send me your email address, I'll give you my email address.
Yes.
My is Derek B. Thomas. Derek spelled with two R's.
You know, Derek, do me a favor. Could you put your details in the chat, and I'll put mine in the chat, and then we can continue offline.
Okay.
But thank you so much for your contribution.
And thank you very much to all the speakers. Very much education to me as well, because I learned quite a lot of my own history. Thank you.
Fantastic.
Thank you, Derek. Juanita, what I would say is that anyone who has lived through that era, the 20s, 30s, 40s, 50s, in that Guyana, in that period, I would really encourage you to write your story, record your story, and we need as many perspectives as possible and many narratives so that we can take this history for historical knowledge forward for future generations. Yes.
Sorry, I don't want to be rude and interrupt, but I'm conscious it's nearly 5 o'clock. Yeah. I wanted to say thank you to Arthur before Arthur had to go. Arthur, I'm sure everybody's joining me in putting their hands together and thanking you. You've been absolutely fantastic. Thank you so much, Arthur. Take care, and we'll be in touch, I'm sure. John, please come in. Go ahead.
I want to respond to a comment by David Shum.
Yes.
Which is a very valid and interesting point. He says that saying that a person is not speaking English when they are speaking Creolese is very disturbing, particularly when what they are saying is ignored. You know, we use the term Creolese, but as I pointed out in my first book, it's dealing with a continuum of varieties. So you have a very varieties in Georgetown that are a lot closer to English. And the Aqualect, we would say. And we have varieties that are rural that are much further away. But for instance, take a point. When you say in Creolese, almost all varieties, I tell you, a CE, you know, that is past tense. It is not present. As long as the verb is a non, what you call a state verb, like no or so on, using the, what we call the present tense form in English actually means the past, right? And you have to use other things like I did tell you or I've been tell you to make the past. Let me give another example. So that is a way in which the one system is not exactly the same as the other. In the Basilek, or the kind of thing that Anna was from Buxton was saying, and Granny was saying, there is no gender in the third person pronouns. E stands for subject and possessive, and am stands for object. So isiam can mean either he, she, or it, saw him, her, or it's again. Similarly, we have this expression we know all the time. If you see blood, if you hear noise, right? It's a very interesting expression. These are cases where people use an if phrase without a then phrase. There's no condition, you know? But it can only be done with verbs of perception. If I see noise, if you hear a thing, if you smell smoke, right? You can't say, if you walk home, impossible. It has to be a verb of perception. So Creole has a set of rules that are quite intricate and different from the rules of English. So while there are some similarities in many ways, there will be fundamental differences that remain.
Thank you for that, John. Claudia, I cut you off halfway through your comment. I'm sorry. Did you have some? No, it was my fault, John. Don't worry. It's because I wanted to make sure Arthur got a formal thank you from me. But Claudia, did you have anything you wanted to add to anything that Derek Thomas had said?
I was just saying that that anyone who has experience of that period should be encouraged to tell those stories, record them, write them down, and because we still don't have sufficient perspectives from that era, and many of the perspectives that we have are still the perspectives of the more powerful, and so we just need as wide range of perspectives as possible so that we can have as rich historical knowledge as possible going forward. That was it, Juanita.
Okay, thank you. I just want to ask you, because you have mentioned that you had done 30, I think you said, oral histories, is that right? Where are your recordings going to be? I mean, how can the public access them?
Yeah, so I have so far completed 36, interviews with 36 individuals, including UC Equiano, Eric Huntley, and right through to the Huntley family, the co-founders of Bogle Overture, the artists, etc. And so that's forming part of my research, which has still got about a year and a half to run. And so that will all be kind of typed up and made available. And so it'll be available to other scholars. And so we'll see what's made available in terms of publications as well going forward.
But so ultimately after the publications, would they, I presume they would just become part of the Huntley archives at the LMA, is that right? Or?
I think they'll become part of my archive.
Okay.
And but they'll be available to any archive that would be interested in them, because it's a broad history of the period rather than only focusing on Jessica and Eric.
Yes. Yeah.
For example, the West Indian Students Centre, where Jessica was a trustee. So I've got completed a separate piece of research, and I have interviewed individuals who didn't know Jessica at all, but were very active in the West Indian Students Centre in London. And but yes, any archive that's interested in the material will be available.
I'm just being particularly nosy because I'm working on the on a project myself at the Institute of Commonwealth Studies, and the project I'm working on is called the Windrush Scandal in its transnational and Commonwealth context. But a sort of side aspect of that project is that I'm hoping to build a kind of composite searchable database of all the oral history recordings that have been done of the Windrush generation here in the UK. And so I'd very much like to be able to point people in your direction if they're looking for any of the resources and the recordings that you've done. So perhaps we'll talk offline about that.
I'd be happy for that to happen, yes.
Oh, wonderful, sure, fantastic. So I think we've got three hands that are raised. Forgive me everyone if you've been putting comments in the chat. I'm trying to go through and read them, but I wanted to bring in those that have actually raised their hands. Charlene Wilkinson. Yeah, so Charlene, if you can unmute and share your comment.
Yes, greetings everyone. I wanted to ask Professor Rickford a question which really is a mounting to ask in advice. The Guyanese Languages Unit, which I coordinate at the university, was in a rather, particularly sensitive position recently when the US State Department approached us. And they said they wanted to use the, they're using the public library to start classes in American English for Venezuelan refugees in Guyana. Mm. So they sent us their curriculum and they said, could you please insert the Guyanese phrases who were relevant into our curriculum? And well, I don't know if people understand my passion and my politics, but I got goosebumps all over the place and I had to ask my colleagues' advice on how to answer them because I found it to be a blatant, ignorant insult against our language. So I tempered my words and I sent a really short answer and I said, it is a very difficult position. It's a very difficult thing to do because of the pervasiveness of the use of Guyanese Creole. We would prefer to offer you a course in Guyanese Creole so you could understand better how to give your, they didn't accept it. They insisted that I inserted the phrases and I insisted that we couldn't do that. And then finally they decided to say, well, could you please send us some students who would be willing to teach with us in the English program? So I turned them over to the education department and washed my hands of that matter. But I was wondering, you know, how would a linguist like you approach it in your usual diplomatic way? This was about to be imperialism, insult itself again, several centuries after British colonialism. Here was American imperialism showing itself. How would you deal with that, Professor Rickford?
Well, that's a complicated question. The first thing I should say is that Charlene and Aleem, the number of linguists at UG are far fewer than they were in my day. When I taught at UG for 6 years, there were about 6 linguists. Now there's 2. And I think you have limited resources. So you have to do more with less. I agree that the challenges facing you with Creole speakers and understanding Creole speakers, and you also, I know, work on Amerindian languages and so on, are so overwhelming with fewer resources than you ever had. I can understand why you choose to concentrate on the current problems of Creolese and Amerindian speakers. That's what I would say for a start. I know your Guyanese languages unit is very strongly being advised and influenced by the Jamaican language unit, which is doing very dynamic work. So I would, again, draw on that relationship in deciding what to do.
That's a very diplomatic answer, Professor Rickford. Thank you so much. And we are, in fact, going to have a collaborative meeting.
Like Derek Thomas says, you know, you have to be diplomatic, you know. You have to
Yes, we have a collaborative meeting coming up with the JLU, in fact.
Right.
Yes.
Thank you for that, Charlene. And you and I need to, at some point, have a discussion ourselves offline from here, because I know you're really keen on making sure that these kind of educational Zooms that we have are shared more broadly. Certainly, you know, it's just Rod and I, and I guess what we've been trying to do is to, just by recording it and have it available on YouTube, make it available as something that can be played back. But you've made the very important point that a lot of people don't necessarily have access to even the internet. So I'm not quite sure what we will do, but we will definitely have to have some sort of conversation to see what we can do.
Yes, and
I'm coming in a minute. Just hello.
And Juanita, I noticed that the Vice Chancellor is in the UG's Vice Chancellor, Dr. Professor Mohammed, is in the meeting with us, and I know she has ideas about community collaboration with communities that she But I mean, this is not for a discussion now, but I'm just pointing out.
Absolutely. And I'd love to acknowledge actually Paloma being in the audience, because I spotted Paloma yesterday. I think it was yesterday, Paloma, correct me if I'm wrong, but I was Friday. We were both on a Zoom at a talk by Melissa Eiffel at Cambridge University, and which was brilliant, I have to say. And I have to invite Melissa Eiffel to come and do a talk here on Guyana Speaks if possible. But Paloma, what has been your response to today's Guyana Speaks event? Have you got any questions or comments you'd like to share?
Hi, good day. Thank you. I was not planning to speak, but thanks very much for the invitation. Professor Rickford and I have been trying to find a photograph that I was not able to find. And so I thank him for the invitation. And I have been joining the sessions, but I've been sitting behind Dr. Tumbridge's when he signs in, so I don't show up. But I've been following the sessions and looking, and they've been quite informative and very inspirational in many regards. With regard to Professor Rickford's work, I have a great debt to pay to him, because one of my book on Caribbean mythology and modern life, a book of plays that I wrote, I don't know, it was like 20 years ago, and I'm like shuddering to think it was 20 years ago, was based on a lot of the research that they had done in a book, a publication at UG many, many, many years ago. I think it was in the 1970s. Also, you know, my own mother's closeness to Mac, McAndrew, and so on. So that is, I've gotten a chance to actually meet him, well, virtually, because I've been corresponding and hearing about him for some time. So thank you very much. But with regard to the two, the specific question that Charlene raised, one of them is, I'm quite in shock to know that the American Embassy had actually gone around me and gone directly to the faculty, but that's not an external conversation to have. So it's clearly, they were determined to do what they wanted to do. So that's one. So Charlene, thank you for letting me hear today that this is what they did, and that you dealt with it in your own inimitable way. But also with regard to the question about what to do with Guyana Speaks, there's such a wealth of context here, such a wealth of history perspective here, and just absolute unwritten knowledge that I think I do agree that it should be something that is much more accessible to persons who do not have access to the internet at this moment. And what we can offer, if this is something that you want to do, UG's radio station is about to be launched, and we will have an opportunity to play back things for persons who do not have access to the internet. It's a terrestrial radio, but we also have an internet site. So that's a possibility. Also NCN as well, and other radio stations that are around the country, because radio is very, very popular still, especially for people driving in minibuses and so on, who are, you know, may not want to listen to the kind of music that some people want to listen to. And also to say, I think we don't only have two linguists, Prof. I think Tamaran Delisa, a Jamaican, is we have a few more. We I think we have a couple that Charlene could talk about, but the linguists of the ones who have been with us for the longest definitely have been Charlene and Alim. But we have, I think, about four or five now, just shy of one you had. So those are my comments, just to say, Rod and Juanita, thank you so much for doing this work, this love of labor. I'm in a certain sense very glad to see that at least it's now online, so that those of us who are not in London can still tune in every Sunday or whenever you have them. And that we are getting to know more. I also have a great fun looking through the list of people who are listening and who've joined in, and to hear them, because some of these people, you know, we would never know where they are in the world. So this is just marvelous. And if I didn't comment on the other two presentations. It's because I joined late. We had a medical appointment this morning. So I came in just after Professor Rickford would have started. So I'll have to go back and listen to the others. Happy that they will be online. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Paloma. I love your suggestion about doing it with UG's radio station. I mean, essentially the point of doing this for Rod and myself is just that, you know, we're so conscious that so many people aren't aware of their own history, and we believe very strongly that we can do it for ourselves. We can share our own history, our own knowledge. I mean, one of the things that's astonished me with Guyana Speaks is that we're still here. Number one, I mean, when we started in 2007, everybody was 2017, everybody kept saying to us, oh, well, you'll be done by the end of the year because there'll be no more Guyanese to contribute. Uh-huh. And I was like, you know, apart from the fact that I didn't believe that at all, but I still, in a sense, it's just been a wonderful journey for Rod and I, because it's just a roller coaster in that automatically in doing something like this, you then end up meeting more and more and more Guyanese and being more and more astonished by just how talented the community is. And that really all that was needed was a forum in which we could come together in order to share each other's knowledge. And so, of course, you know, it is a labor of love, and it is literally just because it's such a rich community to be part of. And we certainly are open to anything that enables this to be distributed more widely. The only thing we're not open to is being involved in anything that is state sponsored. I'm the pessimist, and maybe Rod would think differently, but I've been very disappointed here in the UK with the government's response to incorporating Black history into British history, which of course it is indelibly part of British history, and they're just not kind of shifting on that front. And I just think in the end, I've got to the point where I just don't think it matters. I think we know what our history is, we have responsibility to share it with each other, and that's what's needed essentially. So I'm not interested in the state, we can do this for ourselves. So, that was a sideways response, by the way, to what Charlene had put a comment in, Wilkinson had put a comment in the chat, just asking if getting state sponsorship would kill off Guyana Speaks. And I feel it will, and it would, simply because we do it free, voluntarily, and our speakers speak for us freely as well, but we don't pay anyone. And I think that's a really important part of what we do. You know, we don't want to exclude anyone who can't afford to hear this either, you know. So that's why it's free, and that's why it'll always be free. So, David Chung, please. Pardon me, David. I've seen your hand up for a long time, and I apologize. I should have come to you earlier.
Can you hear me?
We can hear you, yes, fire away.
Okay, fine. I think you can see me as well now.
I can see you, yes.
My question was actually, before I actually go back on this, John, I want to thank you for your response to my question. It was a very informative response, but pardon me, it wasn't actually what I was trying to get at. And I'll come back to that in a minute. I'll just go off record and actually just remind you that we were both at Queen's together. Although you probably can't remember, but remember, I was actually a distinguished mile runner. And I won the mile 3 years running between 61 and 64.
Yeah.
And then I think we briefly met, we briefly encountered, although not personally, because I was back at the university from 76 to 82 in the Faculty of Education. And I've continued to maintain my contacts with Guyana, although from a bit from a distance. Okay, back to the issue with the Creolese. What triggered this off was quite recently an MP in the House of Commons actually made a speech where he was very derogatory about a woman of Caribbean extraction who is a presenter, in a sports presenter on the BBC. And he was suggesting that they should take her off because of the way she spoke. Now, that is quite disturbing, because what that suggests is that in the public domain in the United Kingdom, we have a heck of a lot of work to do to correct this misperception of Creolese. When a significant, well, all of us speak Creolese if we come from the Caribbean, and it comes automatic. I speak Creolese most of the time, and it's not that I'm conscious of it. It just particularly more so when I'm in among my friends, my Caribbean friends. Yeah. And I shudder to think how often people must be thinking, what gibberish is he talking? because you made that point. It's to do with perceptions.
Yeah.
And we know all the time that people are actually interpreting and misinterpreting us when we speak. So my question was basically more, I suppose, political, because I'm operating the political domain now, where I think so many times I'm actually in the public domain, and I'm giving presentations. And I get this feedback, which reminds me all the time that I almost threw my hands up. Well, how the heck are we going to correct this? But they will hear more, wonder. They will probably listen to you more because, you know, we conditioned the idea that if you're an academic, if you're an intellectual, people sit up and listen.
I wish that was always true.
I wish that was true, too.
So there's a lot more. Okay.
The things I must say, first of all, David, if you were a marathoner, you know, in sports, I never made a standard point at anything. I think once I came close to making a standard point at QC in the shot put, but I may have fallen short. The only thing I was captain of the tennis team in form 2C or something like that, but ping pong. And secondly, my wife says that she believes she shared an office with you at UG in education for a little while. So see, Angela, who's on here too, remembers you. The issue you've raised is a larger, more complex issue. If the person is not being understood by anyone who speaks English normally, and that's, I mean, people who usually speak English, but that's what I mean. Then there is no problem. And in fact, there's a great attractiveness to diversity in many varieties.
Did you say when you were drinking the aloe vera?
Sorry, somebody's. I'm just going to mute everyone. Okay, that was too far. It's fine. Can I just mention as well, Gretchen Cummings? I can't find a mute button for you, but sometimes I can hear interference in the background. Okay. I don't know if you've got a button that can mute. Thank you, Gretchen. And good to see you, by the way.
Yeah.
John, please go ahead.
But where the variety involves things, like in some of the varieties of Guyanese Creole that can be quite sharply removed from standard English, I would say, based on my experience with US courts, that you should have interpreters and translators, because in many cases, people are not understood at all. And it always amazes me that court decisions are made, for instance, when they say, we didn't understand anything. So if you look at our 2016 paper, which is on the website now, by the way, we show that Rachel Jontel, in many cases, was not understood, and it would have been to the benefit of everybody for it to have had a translator. That has actually been admitted as a possibility much more in the UK than in the US, okay? And of course, people don't like to hear it because they say, speak English, but the kind of English you speak is not understandable by other people, okay? I think in many cases, they can be understood and can be respected. And in those cases, I would say, David, that you should certainly be allowed to hear them. You know, I watch Vera. I don't know if you watch Vera. It's a British show, you know, the detective, V-E-R-E-R-A. Half the time, I don't understand what they're saying. Mm-hmm. English dialects, she always seems to be in very funny coastal cities or something. But and I have to be played a couple of times, and then we figure out what the person was saying or what the people who were speaking to her were saying. So that is true of many varieties of English, and particularly in the Caribbean or from the Caribbean. So I certainly respect your point, David.
Thank you for that, John, and thank you for your question, David. I have a question now for Claudia. And the question is, did any of the pamphlet women become active in the resistance movement? So,
yes, okay. So this research is very, very difficult to fully unpick and fully uncover. The reason being the fact that it was during a period of repression, and it was conducted under subterfuge. Roberta Kilkenny, who conducted some of the original research back in the with women such as Janet Jagan, discovered that they needed to take the WPO needed to take protective and defensive action, and they did that by destroying a lot of the records of the women's progressive organization members. If you think of the background and the context of frequent raids by the police and by the British Army, it would have been very, very risky to kind of retain those documents. So it's actually very difficult to obtain documents in terms of what might have survived at that period. So that can't be answered at this stage.
That's really interesting, Claudia. So thanks for that. Yeah, it's the whole thing of surveillance. Just sometimes I find it mind blowing. you know, the way it's kind of affected the narratives that we have available to us as historians now as well. Because there's so much that I find, you know, particularly when you're researching here in the UK and you're at the National Archives and then you hear that some further resource material has just been released, and that can actually completely shift the way you would interpret something that, you know, had earlier you thought you had like a full understanding of the circumstances of a situation, and then it's completely changed. But it'll be interesting to see if more does come out over time. The other question I had, I don't know if Uncle Eric is still online, but the question was, the young man on the bicycle who met Jessica on that lonely street is in the audience. Did he offer to give her a lift?
So I do have the answer to that. That was part of the interview, as Eric went into kind of considerable detail about that, but I don't know if he wants to answer that, if he's still...
Let me see if he's still on. I don't know if he's still online. I can't see him. Uncle Eric, no, I don't think. Certainly his name isn't coming up. Can you spot it, Rod? Yeah, no, I can't see him online at the moment. He did come on earlier, but he may have got sort of cut off or had to do something else.
Yeah, so the response that all of the information that was part of my interview with Eric about that situation was that Jessica was well brought up young lady. If you recall, her mother, Hectorine, was very strict, and she wasn't actually, throughout her childhood, permitted to speak to any strangers in the street. And so the idea, of her getting onto a bicycle with someone she didn't know, but according to Eric, it was something that just would never happen. So he walked with her all the way home.
Oh, that's very, very gentlemanly of him. Thanks for sharing that. I'm conscious of the time. It's 5:32. So I'm sure our speakers have plenty of things they need to get on with. But I have one last question, if I may, for John. And the question is, which European language, from the English, Dutch, it looks like Portuguese, most influenced today's Guyanese vernacular? And I think it's reminding me of a lady I met when I was in Guyana in 2006, and she spoke a kind of Dutch Guyanese Creole. And somebody had said to me, oh, she's like one of the last people to be able to speak Dutch Creole. I'm actually wondering what happened to that Dutch Creole. Was there a bleeding of the Dutch Creole into the English Creole, or what happened to it? You're still on mute, John.
Okay, can you hear me now?
Yeah, I can. Thank you.
Yes, well, when I was at UG from 74 to 80, my office was next to Ian Robertson. And you should have him here one day to talk about Burmese Dutch, because he worked a lot on Burmese Dutch and Essequibo Dutch. And of course, the Dutch were in Guyana long before the English. A lot of people spoke what he called Skepi Dutch, which is Burmese Dutch, Burmese Dutch or Skepi Dutch. Basically, to begin with, when the English took over Guyana, they said, look, we're going to tolerate this Burmese Dutch for a little while, right? 5 years, 10 years. And then after that, we will hear no petitions. We will do no business in Guyanese, in Burmese Dutch. You would have to learn to speak English. English are very autocratic in that way. And so a lot of it died out because of that change in administration. But there's still pockets of people, usually upriver, who speak Skepi Dutch. In fact, I remember Robertson first started to tell me that, from historical evidence and looking at the records, there might be something like Dutch. And he went on a trip up the Burmese River, and he came back all excited. He said he had found speakers of Burmese Dutch. So it was very influential, up until the beginning of the 19th century, but it began to lose a lot of significance after that. Now, other people have worked on it, but I think Ian Robertson, who's from Guyana, works in Trinidad, was really the key person to have discussed it.
Fantastic. Yeah, no, I'll definitely... Claudia said she'll kindly share his details with me. So definitely. And also, Charlene as well. Well, okay. So got lots of sources of information there for Ian, which is fantastic. I think we need to really round up there. It's 5:30 and I'm very conscious you've spent a large amount of your Sunday with us. So thank you so much, Claudia Tomlinson, and to Professor John Rickford. You've been amazing and really insightful. There's so much that I've learned today from both of you, and I so much appreciate it. We'll share the recordings with you both, so you can distribute it as you wish. Before we go, I just want to mention that the next Guyana Speaks, I believe, it's on the last Sunday of November, on the 28th, and it's to second generation Guyanese in the UK. We're focusing this week on, in November on Guyanese women, second generation Guyanese women. We'll focus on the men in I think it's February or March next year. But so that's what's happening there. And then we are going to try and do a border bazaar. So we've set a date for the 11th of December at the Jomar Community Centre. And I will put the details of that. Obviously, I'll circulate it via email, as well as have it on our different platforms, on the Facebook and on Twitter. But just to say, we'd love as many people as possible for us to meet up in person. And it's essentially going to be a recreation of the border market, but indoors. And it's an opportunity for people to buy Christmas presents for people that are supporting Guyanese businesses or that have come from Guyana. And there'll be lots of other things going on as well as part of the markets. If there's anybody online who happens to want to be a storeholder, we're charging storeholders £15 to be a storeholder. But anyone who just wants to come and join the fun, it's £2 per person to come in. So that will be on the 11th, Saturday, the 11th of December. And we'll share those details with you. But if everybody just wants to unmute at this moment and let's just put our hands together for our two speakers, that would be fantastic. So thank you so much. And really, really so much appreciated.
Thank you.
We normally have a free-for-all now, John, so feel free to stay or go. I'm going to stop the recording now. Let's just do that.